Welcome to Shop Talk Live, Fine Woodworking Magazine's bi-weekly podcast. I'm your host and Fine Woodworking editor, Tom McKenna. With me this episode are Executive Art Director Mike Pekovich.
Hey, guys.
And web producer Ben Strano.
Hello.
As always, Jeff Rose is manning the camera and keeping us in line.
And Matt Kenny is not here.
He's not in the building.
So there's not much to keep in line.
He's here in spirit, though. Is he? He's here in spirit. Yeah. He's home making a hardwood derby car.
He better be.
Hardwood derby.
Bam.
Is yours done, Ben?
I did it on camera. It's not very good.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, you got to redo it.
Because I did it on camera.
I think Mike is ready to roll.
I actually did two, and I ruined one.
I haven't started mine. I'm doing it just like I used to do the cars when my son was in Cub Scouts, like, you know, 2 days before. So be afraid. Be very afraid.
The exciting thing to me is, though, Betsy and Liz are getting in.
Liz has a great idea. I'm not going to reveal it, it is awesome.
For those who don't know, Betsy and Liz work with us.
Yes.
Yeah.
They hold down the fort and, you know,
keep us in line. Really.
Keep us in line for real. Let's get to some questions. We'll start off with one from Drew. And Drew says, I'm a novice woodworker building my collection of basic hand tools. I need to get a handsaw, but there are so many out there, and they all have different functions. Which handsaws do you consider essential to your work, and which would you suggest for a beginner? That's a tough question, just for saws.
Depends what you want to be doing with your handsaw.
It always comes down to that, what you want to do.
Yeah, if you're going to be cutting down a tree, you need a different handsaw than if you're cutting a dovetail.
Sure.
So let's start with sort of... Let's start near the finish line where, let's say, you've got a table saw, bandsaw, blah, blah, blah. Like, you've got a way to get boards square into the thickness, into the length that you need. So we're really dealing with joinery concerns.
Yeah.
Tenon dovetails and such. I would start with a back saw.
Mm-hmm.
And it can be either rip or cross cut or sash cut, which is halfway between a rip cut and a cross cut, otherwise known as a hybrid cut. Yeah.
Which,
traditionally, you want a backsaw sharpened with a rip profile, which is otherwise known as a dovetail saw. And you can still cut across the grain with that. You can still cut tenon cheeks with that. You can cut dovetails with that.
You don't get in trouble.
Yeah.
You won't get reported.
The two basic flavors of a rip saw are the Western style with the kind of the pistol grip and the Japanese style with the long pole handle. That one cuts on the pull stroke. The other one cuts on the push stroke. Japanese saw is going to be sharper out of the box for a lot less money than a Western style saw. So it doesn't matter which one of those you start with because you're going to want both anyway. So if you want to spend $35 on a nice Japanese saw and go cut your dovetails and all that good kind of stuff, and then later on you want a Western style Lee Nielsen or Veritas or Bad Axe or really nice saw just because you want that saw, you'll end up using that probably more than Japanese saw eventually to be cutting your dovetails, but you'll still like the Japanese saw for cutting trim and doing small parts, and it's really nice to have. So you need a dovetail saw, and you're eventually going to want both a Japanese saw and a Western style saw, I would say.
Really?
So, yeah.
Ben has a look.
Well, I mean, not to get into pull stroke, push stroke, Western, Japanese style. I think that it all depends on if you want to cut dovetails, get a dovetail saw. If you're looking for an all-around good performing, I need to cut something off, I need to cut something in length, you know, square something up, I would just go and get a carcass saw, mid-size carcass saw, and if I'm not cutting dovetails, I have one saw that I use for everything.
Well, here's the thing. My first real woodworking hand saw was a dovetail saw.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a great saw, but I now own two carcass saws. One is a rip and one is a crosscut. And I've started using that carcass saw, the rip, for my dovetailing lately. And I use it as, you know, an all-around handsaw when I need a really nice cut. So I think, as from my view, from what I've learned, I think I would recommend a person buy the carcass saw as a first saw, as opposed to the dovetail saw, which is smaller.
The only place that my carcass saw really leaves me wanting, and I wind up reaching for my dovetail saw. I've cut dovetails with my carcass saw as well, and mine's hybrid cut or sash filed or whatever.
Let's say sash.
Sash filed.
We're nothing hybrid ever, unless you've got a car.
Unless it has a key.
Okay. Mine is sash filed, and I use it for everything. The only place that it's too much saw for is cutting dovetails in like half inch stock. I mean, it's like you look at it and it's past the line.
Yeah. So get a dovetail saw.
Lighten up, Francine. No.
But my problem with starting with a dovetail saw is you get excited about having a saw and you use it for things that you shouldn't use a dovetail saw for. And you wind up ruining the dovetail saw.
You know, I haven't
come close to ruining.
Have you been cutting copper
Not
pipe
all
with
of
it?
Us have the same
actually,
self-control.
Actually, I did try to cut a piece of like aluminum weather strip channel with a Japanese dovetail with a Japanese saw.
Okay.
Because aluminum so soft.
How'd that work?
And fine teeth. It's just like, you know, it's like little kernels of corn just popping off that saw. Yeah, don't do that.
Is that what happened to the saw down at the shop?
No.
Because that's the only Japanese saw I've ever used.
Those are pretty big.
Missing a few, yeah.
Those are pretty big.
Yeah.
No, I do like Mike's idea of the Japanese saw because, you know, those are so versatile and they cut so fast. What the next Japanese saw I want to get is a flush cutting saw, like a little itty bitty one.
And that's your argument. You're going to need it for that.
Yeah. I mean, bottom line is, it's sort of that stupid block rabbit plane from, it's not stupid, it's a nice tool. It's a block plane that's also a rabbit plane with a full width. Why don't I just get that instead of getting a shoulder plane and a block plane? Because you need a shoulder plane and a block plane. I think the most important thing I ever do with a back saw is cut dovetails. I cut a lot of dovetails, and I want my dovetails to be perfect. Mm-hmm. And so I always want to be using the tool most precisely suited to that task, which I think is a dovetail saw.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, there's not a lot that I do with a handsaw other than cut dovetails, really.
And there we go. It just depends on what you're
and if I
doing
did,
with it.
If I did, I would get another saw for whatever that task is. So if it's a carcass saw, bombs away, get a carcass saw, but get a dovetail saw.
But the question's not which one saw.
What to start
dovetail
with?
Dovetail saw.
Well, here's
one saw,
thing.
Dovetail saw.
Yeah.
I say one saw, carcass saw.
Okay, now let's get a... Okay, here's my
two
ideal
saws.
Thing. I've got... so Japanese saw, let's put that off to the side. We'll get a Japanese saw. I have a Lee Nielsen dovetail saw with a rip cut. I also have a slightly larger Lee Nielsen saw filed to a cross cut. I don't know if it's a tenon saw or carcass saw. I'm not sure. It's not giant, but it's bigger than a dovetail saw.
Carcass.
I hate that thing. It always binds. I use it for like a saw hook for cutting parts, you know, in half across the grain. Cross cutting. <Yeah. laughs> Cross cutting parts. I don't like it. It always kind of binds. I'm going to take it to my buddy, Matt, not Matt Kenny, he's my buddy too, a different Matt who sharpens saw blades. I'm going to have that sharpened to a sash cut.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm going to like it.
I think you will too.
So that would be for me, dovetail saw, Japanese saw, and a slightly larger saw in a sash cut.
The good news is hand saws are probably the least expensive of the hand tool lot. And if you're looking at the big picture, if you're comparing it to, you know,
not
a number
my
four.
Saw.
But I mean, it's, you know, $150 to $200, you know, for a really high quality. I think I paid $125 for my dovetail saw. I think it was a Lee Nielsen.
Yeah.
I think it was $125.
That's still about right.
So. And I do love that saw, and I even bought a little leather cover for it and everything.
Aww.
It was awesome.
It's got precious. A little whoopee.
I'm going to walk away from that one as fast as I can. Let's move on to question number two.
I'm glad we dispelled any confusion for him right
This question is from Evan. And Evan says, my question is about finishing drawers, specifically the outside. Sometimes I will leave my drawer unfinished, or often I will give it just a coat or two of shellac. But on the outside, I want to give it some finish to show off the dovetails. If I start finishing the entire side, it looks odd with the rest of the drawer box finished differently, especially if there is any color to the finish applied. What do you do for your case pieces?
On the outside, we're not talking about the face, because the face is just going to get the same finish as the rest of the case. We're talking the outside, meaning the sides.
Yeah.
I go a coat or so or two of shellac and then wax. I don't want a film finish, but I do like that it's sealed, because if you just try to wax bare wood, the wax really soaks in too much. Yeah. You use up too much wax, and it's just nasty. Not great. So a couple coats of shellac. I'm kind of the same way. I either finish the interior of the drawer with shellac, or I don't. And even if I don't, a couple light coats of shellac on the outside before I wax it, it still just kind of looks the same color, but maybe a little shinier. Mm-hmm. So that's a good thing.
I've done both. I mean, the most recent piece I built, I put a coat of shellac on the sides and waxed, and I didn't coat the inside. I just like the smell of the pine on the inside, of course.
Yeah.
You know, the finish kind of overtook it, but
I think if you really want to get your dovetails to pop, though, like sometimes if you're doing kind of a lower contrast woods, you really need the end grain of the dovetails to be a little bit darker. Mm-hmm. So like, let's say I'm doing, I don't know, let's say oak drawer front and oak drawer sides. If I do shellac on that, shellac tends to keep the end grain lighter. Those dovetails are almost going to disappear. And if you do want to show them off, hit them with a light coat of oil, either linseed oil or Danish oil or something like that, mm-hmm. just to soak into the end grain to darken it up. And then, you know, if you want to finish off with wax or a coat of shellac after that, you can.
Would you do that before you assemble?
No, afterwards, because you want to flush up the dovetails and everything.
Yeah, okay, good.
And just hit the outside, yep.
Now, what if, one thing that I edited out of that question was, I think he's specifically talking about if he does something with a Danish oil finish or something. So there's a little bit of color to it. If you're doing, you know, the carcass, if you're using Danish oil or something with a little hint of color, where would you stop using Danish oil and start using shellac? Or
some people who stain, like period guys, they'll have a hard line, but they'll have the stain going all the way across the dovetails.
And use that marking gauge line.
Yes, and stop right there. Yeah. So even though it is getting on the drawer side, I would say don't put any color on your drawer sides unless it's sort of like a period correct thing you're trying to do. Mm-hmm. Just get the color on the front and just hit it with either an oil without color to it on the sides or just shellac on the sides.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that line of color looks off to me most of the time.
Yeah.
On
but
the side.
If it's really, really dark, what you don't want is with the drawer closed and still see a sliver of lighter wood, you know, on the side of the drawer that you might be able to kind of see,
mm-hmm.
you know, if your gaps are kind of big, then you got to sort of wrap that corner just a little bit.
But rebuild your drawer.
Yeah.
I'm just being mad right now.
Throw down the fire.
Start over again. All right. I think we answered that. It's time for our all-time favorite tool of all time for this week. Ben, do you want to start us off?
Yes.
Thank you.
We've been known to walk down the halls of Taunton Press with odd things before, and I've never felt uncomfortable. But this one I felt the need to put in my pocket, because it would just look weird if I was walking down the halls with a big old knife. And Jeff and I were recently at Dave Fisher's, filming him carving a bowl. And while we were there, he broke out the Saloid knife to do a chamfer on the edge. And we got to talking. I was like, what is it with a Saloid knife? Everyone, you know, all the green woodworkers talk about Saloid knife this, Saloid knife that. And it's like, it's a knife, right? And he goes, no. And he showed me. And the big thing is there's no secondary bevel. So it's easy to sharpen. And, you know, you can rest the bevel on an edge, and you know, you have a lot of control with it. The curve of the knife is also very, very important. And we got to talking, and I was like, all right, well, I'm going to get a Sloyd knife, but the ones I've seen were kind of pricey. It seems like $100 for a knife is a bit too much. He goes, oh, man, this one's $20. And I went out. I got exactly the knife he told me to get. It's a Mora. And this thing, I've been using it nonstop. I've been carving up little...
Did you say Amore?
That's a Mora.
You love it. Sorry. Couldn't pass it up.
And it's just been absolutely so much fun using this. I've been carving little spatulas and spoons and things like that. And like the other day, beautiful day out, and, you know, my wife's gardening, my kid's digging in the yard, and I'm just sitting there carving a spoon, and it's just awesome. And I've just been having a lot of fun with it. But it's really, really, really high-performing tool.
So it's a fairly short blade. On the side profile, it kind of curves up to a point. I don't know how you describe that shape, but it's really pointy. And then also the blade is really...
It's a pointy knife.
It's a really thick blade. It's like almost...
Very wide bevel.
It's about an eighth of an inch.
Almost an eighth of an inch at the shank.
And and you can put your thumb back there and push on it and not hurt yourself. Like, you know?
There's no flex going on there.
Yeah.
Just don't put it in the front.
Yeah, I've done that. And there's a few extra little scratches on my hand that I feel like I've been lucky lately.
Did you have to sharpen that out of the box?
Out of the box, it was as sharp as I'll get out. Yeah. And it was, again, this was a $20 knife.
Getting some nicks going on there, too, I noticed.
Well, yeah, I'm going to blame Matt for that.
Okay, let's do that.
Because he's not here.
Because he's not here to defend himself, and he won't listen, so... but I bought a hammer at a flea market, and he said I'll never rehandle it. And if I did, he'd buy me tacos. So that night I had to rehandle it. And as I was flushing that wedge up, I scraped it up against the hammerhead. So I've got a little bit of work to do on this knife now. But
how are the tacos?
Okay. Well, it's at his place, so they're going to be fine.
At his place?
Not at his. It's at his taco.
His
favorite taco.
I thought you guys were having tacos at his house.
No, that'd be.
I was gonna
taco date.
Save that for the next podcast.
Yeah. If we did, we should film it. That'd
How about be you, weird. Mike? What's your toolie?
I have no idea anymore. I lost it.
It's like a flash just went off in his head.
I am going to say because I was. Working in the shop making some little tea boxes, and I had to do some trimming of some tabs. The bottom line is I would have ended up with a piece of waste stuck between the saw blade and the rip fence. So that just wasn't going to happen. So I pulled out my L fence for my table saw, which is probably like one of the greatest table saw inventions ever made. Probably second to the crosscut sled, I would say. Would be the L fence. I mean, the L fence could really be nothing more than two boards that are screwed together in L, and then you clamp it to your rip fence, slightly elevated above the surface, so the workpiece can ride against it, but whatever you're trimming off can sort of slip underneath it. I happen to have the coolest L fence ever created.
The all-time greatest L fence.
And this
the
is
the last L fence you'll ever need.
This is
the ultimate L fence.
One of the inventions of Bob Van Dyke at Connecticut Valley, and he has these, and they make them as a class. And he, you know how Matt was saying last time about the marking gauge, how Bob gave him a marking gauge, but I had to make my own, and he was thinking like, "Wow, Bob really likes me more than you." Bob gave me an L fence. And this is not just the L fence. This is the cool little clampy to the back of the rip fence, L fence, and the L fence with the two star knobs, and it goes up and down. It's fantastic. It is the Cadillac of L fences.
Did you get the DeStaco clamps with them too?
Yes. Yes.
See, if I was giving you an L fence,
yes.
I'm sorry, I would have taken the clamps off.
And in addition, there are multiple fences that attach to the basic box fence that goes to it. And not only they're all have like little T-nuts inset into them, I also got an Altoids box with all the various nuts and washers for the other fences as well.
And they smell like mint still.
And there was a Ziploc bag with the Altoids that he emptied out of the box.
I thought it was, well.
So, But it doesn't have to be crazy. Actually, that art, we did run an article on Bob's little rip fence. Really cool. If you have like the Biesmeyer style fence, which almost every table saw comes with now, make one of these things, because it's impossible to either screw or clamp a regular fence onto that kind of box style fence. This is a great thing. It's got like a U-shaped channel with disteco clamps on the back, which basically when you tighten them, it pulls the fence tight to the good side that you want to be using.
And that's the one that you can also screw the tall fence to,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
anything you want. Yeah. Yeah. So that's really cool. Actually, I think we didn't have room in the article for the L fence.
There's a video.
Is there a video?
Yeah. There's also an online article.
Yeah.
Which really, I think it grew out of the fact that we had to cut a page from the
print so we just
article.
Left out the coolest part of the article, which is the L fence portion of it.
Sorry, yeah, Bob. there's definitely a video. Though.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll post that.
Right on.
Yeah.
Coolio. Well, I guess it's my turn. Years ago, I used to do most of my woodworking in the fine woodworking shop. Because I was really space lacked and had very small children, didn't have time to really set up my shop. So when the day came for me to set up, one of the first things I had to do was build a workbench. And I didn't have a whole lot of extra cash. I didn't have a desire to build, you know, a huge monster type workbench. So I built this really basic bench out of Doug fir 4x4s and 2x4s and MDF and some hardwoods around the rim. And, you know, it's one of those things that people often debate about workbenches. They have to be this, they have to be that. And one of the reasons I'm picking this as my all-time favorite tool of all time is that I had been using the bench at home for a number of things, but I actually built an entire piece of furniture on this really simple workbench. So you actually can do real, quote, woodworking with the rudimentary type workbench. Has some dog holes. Really, I'd like to put a bigger vise on it. You know, I kind of skimped on the vise, I have to shamefully admit, but it worked fine for what I was doing. But like I said, I'd like to put a bigger one on there, and that's about it. That's about the only change I'd make to it right now.
This bench probably cost you a couple hundred bucks in lumber.
I think it was less. The vise was the most expensive part. Mm. I think when all is said and done, but it's, you know, it was actually pretty heavy in that clean photo, but now it's got all junk on the bottom and it's super, super heavy now. And so it doesn't move when I do any real handwork. But I have to say, truth be told, this is not like a hand tool workbench. I haven't done any flattening of panels with hand tools or anything like that. So it's really a bench that I use to assemble and build a piece and use for mostly surface planing, trimming tasks and things like that, mm-hmm. you know.
But there isn't anything about this that would keep you from flattening.
I don't think so. I think the only thing that could do it would be, you know, I think it's very heavy, but maybe it's not heavy enough if I wanted to like flatten boards by hand. Possibly I could see it maybe scooching across the floor, but I don't know.
That's what walls are for.
Actually, that's what lolly columns are for. I have one to the left that I use a lot, that I use occasionally for stabilization. But I don't know. It's one of those things, you know, I think it goes to show that you don't need to start off with this huge monster bench to get started building stuff and having some fun. And you can use this bench to build your dream bench when you down the road. Mm-hmm. Right? So,
well, I mean, not to bring up Dave Fisher again, but we were just at his place. His bench is 4 layers of plywood screwed together. And there's a carcass that looks like a fancy Rubo style bench, but it's not. It's screwed to the wall, plywood, dog holes drilled all over the thing, you know, and it's getting work done.
Yeah.
You know, and he's exclusively hand tools, so it doesn't take a whole lot. And this is 2 layers of MDF, you were saying?
2 layers of MDF, and there are plywood, not plywood, I'm sorry, 2x4 ribs, you know, going all the way across the length underneath the top. There's no sag at all. So, and then I don't know why I did it, but I think I was remembering John White talking about this, but I put a coat or two of seal coat shellac on the top. And mm-hmm. I, you know, John had said to protect it. And then after I had done it, I was like, what am I protecting?
Sort of so, consolidate CMDF a little bit.
Yeah, I think so. It you know, but anyway, that's what I did.
Keeps the glue from sticking.
That does. That's true.
Well, especially with MDF, you don't want to like set a water glass down on it and have it like do that buzz right
yes,
under it.
It just swells right up.
Yeah.
It's like a chia pet. All right, let's move on to some more questions. This one comes from Jordan, and Jordan writes, when I first began building furniture, I purchased a number 4 plane, but recently I added a number 6 and a block plane. Since then, I have not touched the number 4, and I'm considering selling it. I work in pine and cherry and mill everything by hand. I sharpen daily and get great surfaces. The number 6 is more comfortable and works well for every task. So will I ever need a narrower, shorter, and less massive plane? That's a good question. I guess if you're like what you're doing, keep on doing it. But I don't know.
I actually picked this question because it confounds me. Because I have a number 6 and I hate it now.
Really?
I know guys who their go-to is a 5 and not a 4. Mm-hmm. And that's it. So I also know people who like a 4.5 instead of a 4.
I have
a 6 is sort of like combination of a 5 and a 4.5. So it's longer and it's got the wider blade.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
I have a 4.5 and a 4 and I use them both. I mean, I tend to use the number 4 for finishing cuts and for like edges and chamfering and things like that, cuz it's just lighter and more nimble for me, but I use my 4.5 a lot for tabletops and wider surfaces. It's just a little bit more efficient, but I like them both.
I think like my main thing is like, why sell the number 4? Like, because I think 6 months from now, a year from now, when the shine wears off the number 6, I think you might find yourself reaching to the 4.
I don't know. I think the number 6 is a man's number 4. So
that's all caps.
Also, it says a number 4. So what are we talking to Lee Nielsen? Because it doesn't say Lee Nielsen number 4.
It doesn't say what type.
I don't think it's a premium. Yeah. I edited out a few. It's not a premium.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot you can do with a number 4 other than use it as a smoother. I mean, you could put a pretty heavy camber on the blade and use it as a little scrub plane or something like that. I mean, are you saying... Sort of the question is sort of, wow, should I be using my number 4? Kind of. I don't know. Yeah. Bottom line is, no, if you like your 6, like you said,
Tom. Keep it on.
Yeah, rock it. And then if you need the money and you want to sell it because you got something else to buy, sell it and buy another one later if you want it. Yeah.
I mean, it's funny because a hand plane, it doesn't take up, to me, any space. It's not like you're making a conscious decision to like dump your table saw in favor of a bandsaw, you know, to save space or something like that. Ben's advice may hold true. Maybe hold on to it for a little bit longer. You never know.
Or contact me and I'll swap you my number 6 for his number 4. And then he can have 2 number 6s.
Keep one shot.
I mean, the main thing about a number 4 versus number 6, it is narrower and shorter, which typically for a smoothing plane, is going to serve you a little bit better because larger planes are really designed to get the surfaces like flat. Mm-hmm. But then when you're getting for that final polish with the smoothing plane, you actually want to be able to get up and down a little bit in the subtle undulations of the board, which a shorter plane is going to be able to handle for you a little bit better. It could be a kind of thing where you keep your number 4, just keep it in your tool chest or tool cabinet, but keep it really, really, really sharp. So you use your 6 for everything, but then you hit a knot or some quarter sawn figure in your cherry where it's just tearing out a little bit. Instead of having to sit down and sharpen your number 6, just pull out your 4 and hit it. So.
And the other thing, maybe considering what he's doing, and I assume that he's building big furniture, what if someday he wants to make a box? And I think that in a case of like you're making a tea box, that number 6 is going to be the, you know, overkill for the smoothing involved. So maybe you'd want a number 4 for a smaller project down the road. I don't know. I'd be inclined to keep a hand tool, I think, longer than I would.
I think that's the thing we're struggling with. It's a notion of any of us actually getting rid of a hand tool.
Yeah, maybe if you had another number 4.
because I keep my number six because that thing for shooting, it's got a lot of mass behind it.
Yeah.
It's like you get that thing moving and it's getting work done, you know. But yeah, I don't think I'll sell it. But if this guy wants to trade, I'll trade.
Call Ben, 1-800-BEN-STRANO. Let's move on to the next question. This one is from Devin. And Devin says, I'm building a cabinet for my sister's wedding gift. It has cherry face frames and two doors with cherry frames and curly maple panels. What is the best surface prep before shellacking the panels? I was planning to plane or card scrape it, but I've heard using a lower grit sandpaper can help the figure pop.
I think the only reason you want to go with any sort of a lower grit sandpaper, meaning like 150 or so, if you're staining it and you need the scratch pattern to hold the pigments of the stain. If it's a clear finish on something really curly, get that thing as smooth and scratch free as you can. And maple is so dense. I've sanded maple like up to 1200 grit sandpaper because you will see even 600 grit scratches in the surface. So no, just go for it. And if you want to pop that figure a little bit before the shellac, wipe on a coat of linseed oil or something to get some oil in there to sort of saturate those fibers before you hit it with shellac will pop. That's always those things. Like, for instance, cherry is one of those woods that can be somewhat blotch prone. So a coat of shellac before like a wiping varnish will minimize blotching. But blotching is just another name for bad surface prep, where it would be nice figure, but if it isn't prepped, it's blotching. So shellac is one of those things, if you want to prevent blotching, throw it on first, but you're always going to sacrifice a little bit of luster in highly figured wood. So if you want the most from maple, get that just as dead, flat, smooth, and perfect as you can. Hit it with a little linseed oil first and then your shellac. I think you're good.
I mean, I'm always hesitant to take, just because I'm still figuring out hand planes, I'm hesitant to take a hand plane to anything with a lot of figure.
Depends.
Just because, I mean, you're that's where you're going to get some tear out.
See, I tend to use hand tools more for that. And I've had, as I get better sharpening, you know, I think I'm pretty good now. And I've been getting better results on tough grain. And I feel more confident also in my card scraper. You know, kind of fixing up anything that's left behind. But I do typically sand anyway after hand planing figured or tough grain.
And not all figures created equal.
Yeah,
I mean, that's true. Maple, it's a really adhesive wood. Like those fibers are really stuck together. With a short plane, you can easily plane tiger stripe maple with zero tear out.
Okay.
Slightly, you know, much less figured cherry is going to cause you a lot more problems. And then on the quarter sawn faces, quarter sawn cherry is notorious for tearing out if you're not careful.
I experienced that this weekend.
Yeah.
I had, on the cabinet I built, I had this wild maple board. It was spalted, but it had curly, it had tiger, it had like every imaginable figure in it. So that took me a while to get surfaced. So, I mean, I sharpened a couple times, I think, between, because I did get Terra, because there are so many areas where it just changes direction and there's no way to control it. And I'm not going to sit there and go 2 inches one way and 1 inch the other just to do it. So it was a combination of hand plane and card scraper and some sandpaper.
Yeah, for maple, the toughest thing is to try to keep it from tearing out during the milling process. That's the thing is, you're not going to create tear out really with a sharp hand plane, but going over a joiner or planer, you can get really deep scallops where that grain changes direction, which are literally impossible to plane out, because even something that could be maybe like a quarter inch diameter little scallop, it could still be almost like a 16th of an inch deep. You're not planing a 16th inch off of that surface.
Exactly.
So you kind of live with it. You reduce it where you can. You sort of live with it. You start to pay attention to your faces. And if there's more tear out that you can get rid of, that goes on an inside face. And you know, you start to kind of play all those games. And then you pull out the scraper and you hit those areas. Okay, and there's a real slight dish you're imparting there.
Yeah, just
it's
don't
better
tell
than
me.
The tear
yeah,
out.
Just don't
yeah,
tell.
So I always find that the milling, if you have really sharp joiner planer knives and you can minimize the tear out at that phase, hand planing is easy.
Yeah. But Mike's tip about the linseed oil works great. I used it, I've only used it once, but I had made a small table for my back porch, and I'd gotten some really nice birdseye maple panels for the tabletop. And I did that trick with the linseed oil before I shellacked it, and it looked great.
Does it have to cure before you put
it on? Not really. Shellac's pretty forgiving that way. Really, really thin. Wipe it really, really dry. Yeah. Okay. And you don't have to, you know, wait 2 weeks before you can do the shellac. The linseed oil is going to yellow up the maple, and a lot of people like to keep it as white as possible.
It yellows over time.
Even then, I would say go with like a Minwax wipe on poly, which is still oil-based. You're still going to get the luster from it. But it's going to...
That's what I used on my table.
It's going to sort of oxidize a lot less in the way that linseed oil will. Mm-hmm. And it starts more clear, so you're not going to get the amber cast that some of the other wiping varnishes throw on there. So that might be the best of both worlds.
Mm-hmm. Well, I put the finish on my table in the fine woodworking shop, where it's like the Sahara. it dried. That stuff dried really fast. Let's move on to our all-time favorite technique of all time for this week. How about we hit you up first, Mike?
Okay. I probably mentioned this because this is really cool. My all-time favorite technique of all time for this week is opposing wedges. And I'll just leave it at that. So I'm making a couple dovetail tee boxes. These boxes are somewhat long, maybe like 10 inches plus long, but they're only about 4 inches wide. So you have this box dry fit and dovetailed together. It's kind of hard to get this thing apart because you can't get a mallet inside this 4-inch space. You go whack, 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 whack. Hitting up and down. It's not fun. So just get a rectangular piece of MDF, cut it at an angle at the bandsaw to make two wedges, plane them down. Stick one wedge in one way along one set of dovetails, the other opposite. Tap it with a hammer, and it just spreads that joint apart in a really controlled fashion. Get it about halfway apart, pull the wedges out, put them on the opposite end, tap those until it spreads those apart. And there's no torque, there's no breaking, mm-hmm. there's no bonking with a mallet inside of a really small space. Works really, really well.
Nice. I like that.
And do you keep them or do you throw them out?
They were halfway in the scrap thing, but then I broke a box and I had to make two more. And I was
you didn't break it with the wedges, though.
No, so. I did not. Yeah. That's a whole different story. That would be a good smooth move. Fortunately, we don't have one this week, so I don't have to go into it. But I did fortunately keep the wedges. But it is one of those things. It's you make it when you need it, throw them away. A few months later, it needs more imposing wedges because you're often sizing these to a specific width that you're trying to get into.
Yeah. It's funny. I tend not to throw little doodads like that out. I have so many clamping calls, thrown around my bench, but even wedges, I don't think I would throw out. But
that's one nice thing about working in a communal shop. It's like, you gotta throw it out. It's like,
yeah.
Well, the problem is, if I intend to keep both wedges, I'll lose one.
That's true.
And then I get a wedge.
Or with me, I'll step on it and then twist my ankle.
Oh, yes. So, yeah.
Anyway, how about you, Ben?
Mine is a riff on a Bob Van Dyke tip where he uses keyway keys from the hardware store bin to, as little spacer keys or as gauge blocks. And I put this in an e-letter not long ago, and it blew up. Everyone loved it. And because it's a fantastic tip. You can get these things for 50 cents, just leave a box of them. I've got a nice set of gauge blocks, little Lee Valley ones that is like $20, but I use those all the time. But down at the fine woodworking shop, I didn't have them, and I didn't have any hardware store keyway keys. So I had a bunch of Allen wrenches, and I used an Allen wrench turned on its side to, offset something perfectly a quarter of an inch. I think I was using it to move. I think I was doing a drawer bottom groove or something like that, and I used it to move the fence over a perfect quarter of an inch on a consistent basis.
Wow, I never would have thought of that.
Yeah.
Makes perfect sense.
Okay. Yeah.
And the keyway keys, are those available in different
Yes.
Dimensions.
Yeah, normally in like 16th inch, although probably down at the low end, you know, there's a little Hillman box in just about every hardware store.
Is it the little gray things? You pull it out, you lift up the lid, and it's all, I love that. And you got the little baggies you're supposed to put, you know, right? Oh, yeah. How much you're on right. there.
And then the price.
I'll tell you, they're great until someone drops one of those boxes, and you're the guy working at the hardware store.
Got the hardware.
The only thing worse is the box of O-rings.
Yeah, I remember when I worked in the lumberyard back when I was in high school. One of my duties was, and it was the worst thing in the world. It was worse than carrying drywall. Was tending to the nail and hardware bins.
Yeah,
because people are just sloppy. They don't put the nails in the right boxes. They're just
we asked them not to put them back. It's don't even, if you pull it out of a box, do they not listened? Try and put it back. Yeah, because we would leave little buckets, and then when you're bored, you'd go through. Because, I mean, if you work in a hardware store, you can look at something and know exactly the size and the length and everything.
After a while.
It's a skill, and it's way quicker for me to put your stuff back than for me to pick through the stuff you put
back. That's true. I should have made it easier for them to discard into some sort of a bucket. Anyway,
I think the solution my local Home Depot arrived at is never police the screw and nail bins ever. And on one hand, it's really frustrating because you go to the size you want, you'll get three of what you want, and then you get the three more, you realize, oh, they're either too big or too small.
Yeah.
The good thing is that if you go and the bin you want is empty, chances are you can look a little left and right, you can find what you'll want. So I always take the good with the bad. Yeah. I don't begrudge that.
Yeah.
Because if they're perfectly ordered and your size is missing, it's like, dang, they don't have it. You know, all hope is lost.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, with that kind of hardware, though, I tend to buy a whole lot of extra because it's so cheap. So I go up in a size and I go down in a size.
Yeah. Yep.
Just because I don't want to go back to
and
the
store.
And then you
say, I'll have this for later. And then you have the one drawer with all the odd sizes of everything.
No.
I just discovered when I was looking for some sandpaper, I opened up a cabinet and I found three or four bags of those hardware store things where you write the quantity on it. I was like, oh, I should have returned those.
Yes. Oh, it's a bag with three small washers in it. Yeah. Great.
Okay. What can I do with a washer?
I'll need this one day.
No. The worst thing you can do at a hardware store is to walk back in with three washers and try and return them. Because that's like the moment you leave, everyone's going like, this guy drove all the way here for 15 cents.
Yes, he did.
But the Allen keys, they're in every shop because 12 come with every you know, tool you purchase.
Sure.
So like that to me is like, you know, we have
a
bin of Allen keys. That's like, you know, there's three or four quarter inch Allen keys in there. So, and you never throw those out because.
No. Every time you get an office chair from Staples, you have to put it together. Yeah. They give you a little Allen key.
Or the IKEA little.
Yeah.
Everything.
Oh, that's, yeah.
The teeny tiny Allen key. I actually stole one from here for home.
What?
Yeah. Shh.
We'll have to talk after the podcast.
Okay.
I still have to do my
Yours.
Technique. Oh, one of my all time favorite technique of all time for this week. I built this cabinet on stand, and the cabinet and stand in combination were pretty heavy, and I couldn't imagine ever moving it as a unit, and so I made a decision to just put dowels into the aprons of the base and just mount the cabinet on that. So basically what I did is I grabbed, I have a Dowel Max dowel jig, and it's a fabulous dowel jig. And so I used that to drill the holes for the dowels in the rails, or the aprons rather. And then I used dowel, what do they call those things with the dowel points?
Dowel pins.
Dowel pins, the things dowel right in the photo there. I can't remember what they're called. I think there was dowel points. Anyway, it's in the photo. You can see them. But you basically insert them into the dowel hole you drilled and put the piece on top and align it. And all I had to do was kind of tap on the top of the case. And then I had two marked holes for me to drill, the mating holes for the dowel. And then I really wanted the dowel to be about a heavy 3/8 inch tall. So I took I created a spacer out of a piece of hardwood, drilled a bigger hole than the diameter of the dowel, placed it over the dowel, taped it down, and then used a, actually, I think that's my crosscut saw right there. to cut it to length. And then I just rounded over the top of the dowel with some fine files and then put a little dab of wax on it to make it easier to engage the hole in the bottom of the case.
I like the spacer block thing, and you've done that with tenons and things like that too. But I think I would have just drilled the hole probably too deep and then sat there with the hammer trying to tap the dowel in.
Oh, yeah, I love that.
Back in the old days,
too far, and then you're...
Yeah, back in the old days, I probably would have done something like that too.
I always used to, like, you know, put a scrap down there or my awl and measure it and try to cut it off exactly so when it bottomed out. And to your point, Ben, if you're not quite shallow enough, you're stuck with a pin that sticks out too much. So I'm like you. I go a little deeper, and I just love that element of risk. Tap, tap. Okay, I'm gonna leave it right there.
But yeah, spacer blocks, they work for everything.
Yeah. Very cool.
I even used a version of that when I was clamping my drawer pulls and door pulls on. I had basically a dowel on the end of the pull, and when I put it through the hole for the door, I used a spacer block of that fashion to clamp the pull in place without the dowel kind of interfering, the protruding back interfering with the clamp. So
the only thing you could have done to make this process more precise was to have, like, actually riven out your own dowels.
I did for the door pull or the drawer pull. I made my own dowels. These are not homemade dowels, but I made my own for the door and the drawer, which I love. I love doing that. I think you make your own dowels occasionally,
right?
Of
course, yes.
What's better than pounding a piece of wood through a round hole?
Yeah.
I mean.
with a 3-pound sledgehammer.
Why? Everything. Every time I make dowels, if my wife is home, she'll come to the top of the stairs and say, "Everything okay down there?" Anyway. Are we running out of time yet? I think we are.
Gosh, it feels like
getting there.
Well, I'll finish with a question from Zeke, who's Z, the last letter in the alphabet. And Zeke says, "I'm not going to have access to my shop for about 5 months due to a move. And I was wondering if you have any ideas on how I can continue with some woodworking while living in an apartment with neighbors above, below, and to the side of me. I've considered learning and taking up spoon carving and perhaps bowl carving. Any suggestions?" Those are good options, spoon carving, you know.
How loud is that? You probably need to get a tree stump in your living room to chop on.
Yeah, maybe you can go outside and do the hatchet work.
Yeah.
Maybe.
You know.
You could whittle spoons. You could,
the
you know.
Whittling part, and I might have been whittling in the living room, carving a spoon the other day, and I thought, oh, this is going to be great. Well, you wind up with chips all over the place, and Katie walked in. She was like, "You're gonna clean that up."
She's
right?
an artist, so that's
She got it, but there was cleanup involved. The thing that I was thinking though is Kumiko.
Yeah, I was thinking that as well
because that's very small and consolidated.
You have to do some initial machining of the stock, but if you can just knock out all of your stock ahead of time, you got your little strips of wood. You can even do the notches by hand too, which is a traditional way to do it. Yeah, turning I thought you could do.
Yeah. Well, Chris Gochner, remember years ago, he and his wife and family lived in D.C. in an apartment, and he had a workshop, so-called, set up in one of the bedrooms of the apartments, and we did a full article, a project. I think it was his tool cabinet or a tool bed. I think it was a tool cabinet of some sort or a chest. I can't remember what it was, but in an apartment in D.C., from start to finish, Chris did it. I don't think he had any power tools. I think he just had his workbench and his hand tool collection. It may have been a hand tool-oriented project that I'm remembering. But it's possible to do.
Yeah.
Do some cool, like marquetry. Get yourself a little scroll saw or even just a little fret saw.
Yeah, scroll saw. Pretty quiet.
Go crazy. Create all these, like, world map, type of veneers, you just go through all these and then you have all these to stick on a bunch of furniture later on.
With any of them though, the stock preparation is going to be,
that's the difficult key.
But I mean, Kumiko, could you go and could you use like, you go to Home Depot and get the,
lath
or
pine lath or something.
I guess you would have to rip it out and.
Yeah, I'm trying to think if, like, if you want to go the hobby route and try to buy some stuff, but
yeah.
I mean, you could, I mean, in theory, there's no reason why you couldn't just make boxes, you know, just hand tools, and you can get the lumber thickness to your,
yeah,
to the dimensions you want, or you can get close and plane.
Or,
I mean, that's loud work, dovetailing.
He has a shop now, so he could prep a bunch of stock and hope for the best woodworking.
That's
wires.
True. It's only a temporary thing. Yeah. That's true. Yeah.
And bottom line, I mean, if you're going all hand tools, you can just start with any stock. You just get your workbench, get your tools.
Spoon making sounds really cool, though. If it's only a small delay of five, you know, a short 5 months, it's going
to
make
fun.
A bunch of spoons. You know, I'd love to do that.
It's addictive, too, and it's fun, and I'm having a blast learning it and just messing around.
What I really like about the question, and it's something that we sort of, like, didn't even question, is, like, I'm in a situation where I can't woodwork for 5 months. Like, what can I do? I'm not going to have my shop. And we're all like, oh, yeah, okay. You know, there's a lot
of
things.
You'll get through this, man. It'll be okay.
Remain calm. Call 1-800-BEN-STRANO. He'll calm you down. All right, well,
you could watch videos. You can watch fine woodworking videos for five months straight.
Or come to Fine Woodworking Live.
Yes.
Well, not for 5 months, but anyway. Pretty hard.
Oh,
that's good. All for this episode of Shop Talk Live. Tune in again next week on April 21st, 2017 for a special live episode of Shop Talk Live from Fine Woodworking Live 2017. We really killed
Mike's
that
looking
one.
Like yeah, we no, haven't talked about yeah, this.
No, I found, okay, here's a better thing to do for 5 months. Go to Unfinished Furniture Place, get yourself like a little pine coffee table.
Yeah.
And just chip carve that sucker for 5 months.
Oh, I had a different idea, like just smash it.
And try and glue it back together.
There you go. Actually, that's a pretty cool idea.
Sorry.
Carve the bejesus out of it.
Yeah.
Where was I? Oh, yeah. Live, Shop Talk Live at Fine Woodworking Live.
Shop Talk Live Live.
Yeah, we're going to kill it. Please spread the word about Shop Talk. What?
Anybody sitting in on that show?
I don't think officially that we'd want to say an area.
Yeah, we don't want to reveal the details. It's a secret. It's huge. Please spread the word about Shop Talk Live to your woodworking friends and neighbors. Shop Talk Live is dependent on your questions, so make sure to send them in to shoptalk@taunton.com. You can subscribe to the podcast via iTunes, and while you're there, please give us the all-valuable 5-star rating, and don't forget to leave your comments. If you're watching on YouTube, please click that thumbs up button. Finally, you can keep up with Fine Woodworking on Instagram and on Facebook, and look for all of us on Instagram as well. Thanks for listening, and have fun in the shop.
Oh, we gave a really stupid answer last podcast about an electrical motor for a jointer. And my buddy Sean, who's very smart and very patient, emailed me. I could hear him sighing as he's answering this.
Mike, I just want to let you know on motors, they usually have a pair of capacitors.
Capacitor. Flux capacitor.
One of the capacitors is a starter capacitor.
Capacitor.
You just need to replace that probably.
Flux capacitor.
Well, another thing, Mike, is these capacitors can have the capability of upholding a charge. So, like, you want to be careful that you don't, like, zap yourself.
Very displeased with my performances in the past podcasts. Mix-wise. I don't expect much out of myself, you know, on camera. But... No, my remixes are all brilliant.
That's what I thought.
It's just the audio could be better.